Hi everyone, I'm Lalit Singh. So now that we have seen the life cycle of activities and explicit intent, now we are going to go deep dive in implicit intents and how exactly activities work around with implicit intents. In this particular session, we are going to check out, we are going to go through with the intents again, just a small recap, and then we are going to learn about implicit intent more and how exactly we can send different implicit intents across the Android system and receive the implicit intents. So let's just do a small recap. We all know what is intent. Intent are the classes which are used to invoke the fundamental components like activities, services, broadcast receivers. We also looked at that block diagram where whenever you click on any application, intent is getting fired and the Android system then checks out for that particular action and then the app component turns on. So where exactly we can use intent? To start an activity, to start a service, and to start a broadcast receiver. How exactly we use intent in services and broadcast will be covered in later sessions. Types of intents. There are basically two types of intents, explicit and implicit. Explicit, we already know when we have specific class to cover and we know in which class we really want to transfer. And we already have seen the practical demo of it. And now we are going to learn about implicit intent. In implicit intent, we don't have source and destination. We all know that much. And all we earn, the implicit intent work with actions and data. Let's say I want to open up a map. And in that, I want to open up a particular location. Now, for that, I need a map application. I need a map activity who can handle it. Now, that can only be done by a map application. So, from my application, I will invoke or I will create an implicit intent. With the help of that, I will be able to transfer to that map application. And in turn, it will open up my map activity. So you see, I didn't even have to know the name of my activity, which was there in my map application. I was still able to open up my my location. In the same way, a camera works. From my own application, I can invoke the system's camera or the camera application which comes inbuilt in your Android device, and you can take a picture and you can just get back the picture from that particular application. It is true that there might be a chance the same action can be handled by different applications. For example, let's say you want to open up a website, and inside your Android device there are more than one web browsers. So at this point of time, whenever you will open up a link, your app will provide you with the different options. That is, let's say you have Chrome browser also and you have your Opera also installed in your Android device. So your Android device will ask you in which one you want to open up. So this process is known as intent resolution, and it is being done at the Android runtime. It matches with whatever the registered intent handlers have been registered for that particular action. So how exactly your Android runtime matches the correct application to open up? Well, that happens with the help of intent filters. We will see the usage of intent filters as we move on. And if there are applications, if there are more than one application, then your app chooser will give you the option to choose one application. This is how your app chooser looks like. You must have come across this kind of situation where you have to choose one of the applications to execute that particular action. So how do you send your implicit intent? Well, you can send an implicit intent by calling an object of intent, and inside that you put your action. Now, it's not necessary that you have to put the data too. An implicit intent can only be created by just action too. Let's say I want to create an intent which will allow me to call. For that, I will provide an action, intent.action_call_button. Now, before I fire this intent, I need to check whether if there is a package who can handle this particular request. So for that, I use a condition intent dot resolve activity. And inside that, I do what? Get package manager. If this whole thing doesn't return me a null, then only fire the intent. Now, how exactly I can pass the data along with my implicit intent? Well, for that, again, there will be an action, and to set the data on data bound part, you can always use intent.setData and your data URI. Let's say if it is a dial action you want to perform, the data URI will be URI.parts tell and your phone number. Let's say you want to connect to a website. At that point of time, URI.parts HTTP and your website link. In the same, for this also to execute, you will again check out if this kind of application is actually present inside your Android device or not. If it is present, then only fire your intent. So how exactly I provide my data URI? To provide my data URI, I use URI.pass and then I provide the data scheme. Now, data scheme depends upon which kind of data you are passing. Let's say I'm passing a telephone number. At that point of time, my data scheme will become tel. If I'm passing a longitude and latitude for maps, it will become geo. And for your URI and for your website, it will become HTTP. So these are few examples which we can take a look at when we are using implicit intent. So I have my URI for Google, and to view this particular website in an application, I'm using an action known as intent.actionView, which is a generalized action. And and along with, I'm passing URI too. I can pass URI as a second argument right when we are declaring my intent object also, or I could have used it.setData and then pass URI at that point of time too. And then I need to trigger my intent. That I do with the help of start activity. If I am creating a phone number, or if I want to perform a dial action now, at that point of time, the data URI will be tell and the phone number, and again trigger the activity. How can I pass my extra data with the implicit intent? It's just like we do in our explicit intent. Here also, I will create my intent object, and I will use put extra method to put the data. I will put the key can be anything, and I will put whatever the data I want. I can put the data by getting from the user. If I have an edit text defined in my layout, I could have just done edit text dot get text to string and then pass that string as a data. And then to fire it, I will check if there is a particular action, if there is a particular application to handle that particular action, then only fire it. You can add more additional information into your implicit intent by providing categories to them. For example, whenever we open up any website, now, how exactly they know that there is a particular activity which can open up a website? Because that activity has one more additional information known as browsable. In the same way, if you are creating your own browser, or if you are creating your customized browser for your Android device, you also need to add inside the activity, or you also need to define inside the activity tag that this activity is a browsable category. The category gives you additional information to help the intent filter to find your activity better. If I want to add a type and category programmatically, I can use it. I can use the intent object and then set the type. For example, I want to set the type for text or HTML file or application or PDF file, and then I need to add a category that what kind of if I'm using a file, then it will be a intent.category openable, because it's a file, it should be openable. Or it can be, let's say I'm creating a browser, at that point of time it will be a category intent.category browsable. And when I'm done with that, I need to check if there is application which can handle that request, and then fire that intent by using start activity for result. Now this time I'm expecting result from my second activity back to my first activity. And that's we have already discussed in my explicit intent. Now there are some common actions for implicit intents. Now for example, action set alarm, action image capture, or action create documents. So these are some action which you can use along the way while you are using your implicit intent. You can use action set alarm for setting an alarm, or action image capture for opening up a camera, or create a document for creating a file. There are apps which can handle common actions. For example, alarm clock, calendar, camera, contacts. They all can handle your alarm, set an alarm action. And similarly, we can use emails, file storage, maps, or music or video file to access your external storage. So for that, there will be an action where you can access your external storage as common. How exactly implicit intent receives? To receive in an implicit intent, you need to know about intent filters. Now, whenever you declare any component, whether it is activity, service, or broadcast receiver, and you want them to receive a particular request in the Android manifest file, while you are declaring your component inside that tag, you need to put an intent filter tag too, which will actually distinguish between them with different other applications. For example, let's say I have an application. Inside that application, there are two activities. One activity will be a launcher activity, and another activity will be a browsable activity. So how do I do that? Inside the Android manifest file, I will put an intent filter tag, and inside that intent filter tag, in first activities, I will put a launcher category, and in second one, I will put a browsable category. And of course, there will be a different actions also. So this is how we actually define it. So if there is an activity tag, there will be an intent filter and action name. And this time around, this activity is using will be used for sharing. So the action can be an inbuilt action, or a user-defined action can be also used. Category I'm using is default. And the MIME type. And the MIME type which I'm using is text plain. So it will be sending, or it will be sharing only text plain data. Now, how exactly we define the actions? Now, actions may be a constant, and these constant will be system defined, like action view, a generalized action, action send for sending something, or action dial for getting to a dialer. And categories like browsable for making your activity behave as a browser, or launcher for making it a launcher activity, or openable for making it as a file. Only action and category doesn't help you to find your activity. Sometimes you have to provide the additional information with the data too. Now, what kind of data we are talking here? It can be a data scheme like HTTPS. It will be a HTTP, now that particular activity will be able to handle all the HTTP requests. If I put data scheme as tell, now that activity is perfectly capable to handle all your tell requests, or dial or call requests. In the same way, you could have used an attribute Android host. Now, in that host, if you put a particular host in there, now your activity will only accept the intents from that particular host. In the same way, you can always define MIME type. What kind of types are acceptable to your documents? An activity can have multiple intent filters. So it is completely acceptable that in a particular activity, you are defining two different intent filters. One is telling your activity to behave like a send, that is a normal send action. And another one, it is another intent filter you are defining for a multiple send. That you can send more than one file. So both are acceptable. Or you can have more than one action inside a single intent filter also. So that also is allowed. While you are defining your intent filter, you can define more than one action, or more than one categories, or more than one data inside a single intent filter too. To learn more about implicit intent, the categories, and the data schemes, you can follow the following links. Now we are going to see the practical for implicit instructor.